المصطفى بلغ مقاصدنا واغفر لنا ما مضى يا واسع الكرم.
يا بدر الزيستر السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. I just recited a verse from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wherein Allah ta'ala talks about the importance of cooperation and the importance of coming together and uniting and supporting each other. This is an act that is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, nothing is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when people come together and they unite and they actively take part in good activities. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. That cooperate with each other and support each other and help each other. فِي الْبِرِّ عَلَى الْبِرِّ. On the principles of goodness. So what Allah ta'ala says is that when you see a good opportunity and when you hear a good call and you see something good happening, you also take part in that. Not because you want to take part in this because of yourself, but because of the good that exists in what you want to be part of. And that's why the good really ought to unite us. And Allah Ta'ala says, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. And also, taqwa, one of our mashayikh said that the meaning of taqwa is positive contribution. Taqwa, obviously, it's translated as also being, you know, the concept of fear, you know, this is one, but this is not definitive translation, by the way. Taqwa means positive contribution, because taqwa means when you have the conscious, and you have the Rabbani fikr, and you have the conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and having the conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to take part in good activities. To be part of a revival and to be part of a form of positive contribution. وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he said hadith fi sahih Muslim an Abi Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu qala Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, إن الله يرضى لكم ثلاثا. Allah Ta'ala is pleased with you from three things. فيرضى لكم أن تعبدوه ولا تشركوا به شيئا. Allah Ta'ala is pleased with you that you worship Allah Ta'ala without associating any partners with him. And the hadith goes on that Allah Ta'ala is pleased with you in three things and is displeased with you. وَيُكْرَهُ لَكُمْ ثَلَاثًا. So three things Allah Ta'ala is pleased with. If you do these three things, Allah Ta'ala will be pleased with you. And if you don't do these three things, Allah Ta'ala will be displeased with you. The first one is abstaining from shirk. The second thing that Allah Ta'ala is pleased with is what? وَأَن تَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ. That you hold on to the rope of Allah Ta'ala, which is Al-Qur'an Al-Kareem, regarding which Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala says, وَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. See, we always remember the first part of the ayah, وَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ, وَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ. And we forget جَمِيعًا and we forget وَلَا تَفَرُّوا. Whereas Allah, the whole ayah is, وَعْتَصِمُوا, hold on to the rope of Allah, hold on to the Qur'an. Collectively, Allah Ta'ala loves collective efforts. Allah Ta'ala loves when there's the Jama'ah. Why is Jum'ah so blessed? Jum'ah is beloved and is more blessed. And it's the day of happiness. It's because we come together. Because we all come together and we stand together and we pray together and we make dua together. This union of Jum'ah and this congregational union is what makes Jum'ah blessed. Because when we are gathered together and there's 100 of us or 500 of us or 1,000 of us, when we are together, we don't know whose Ameen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept. So the second thing that Allah ta'ala loves and is pleased with from the Ummah, from humanity, is what? وَأَن تَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ, that you hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. So the first thing was what? Abstaining from associating partners with Allah ta'ala, shirk. Second thing, holding on to the rope of Allah ta'ala. وَيُكْرَهُ لَكُمْ قِيلَ وَقَالَ. So we have three things Allah ta'ala is pleased with. Number one, that we worship Allah ta'ala, tawheed, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and holding on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number three, not dividing and not separating and not breaking ties. Tafriq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not like tafriq. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib karramallahu ta'ala wajhahu al-kareem, he said that truth unites and falsehood divides. Stay with the truthful no matter how few they may be, and stay away from the false no matter how many they may be. And he said, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, shaitan first creates discord in congregation, then divides and destroys. The Quran says, وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, and the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said, what did he say? وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. And Allah ta'ala, he does not like these three things. What are they? وَيُكْرَهُ لَكُمْ, he's displeased by these three things. قِيل وَقَال. Just by saying this and that, just gossiping and saying, oh, he said, she said, oh, this, what is that? What does this qil wa qal do? What this does is it creates disunity amongst us. It's the beginning. Spreading hearsay, spreading rumors, this is the beginning of division. Spreading rumors about people, these kind of things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also does not like wa kathratu su'al. وَكَثْرَةَ السُّؤَالُ. Allah Ta'ala does not like excessive questions, especially when the questions are not productive. Allah Ta'ala does not like the fact of having excessive questions. Because sometimes we ask questions and questions and questions, not for the purpose of learning, but for the purpose of looking down on people. Questions are good. They say, حُسْنُ السُّؤَالِ نِصْفُ الْعِلْمِ, that a good question is half of knowledge. But that's it, it's a good question. And the third thing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa said that Allah ta'ala is displeased with is wa idha'ati al-mal, wasting money, wasting wealth. This is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because there are people who are needy of this. And that's why, my brothers and sisters, someone said something amazing. He said that there's more power in unity. There's more power in unity than division. And Allah Ta'ala in the next portion of the ayah says, وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. If we look around the board, and if we look around the globe, what we see is that a lot of the times people come together. People are coming together and uniting and holding hands. But their holding hands is not happening for good reasons. In fact, they are holding hands in corruption. They are holding hands in zulm. They are holding hands in looking down on people. They are holding hands and coming together to go against someone who's doing something good. And this is history. This is, look at the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look at our own Islamic history and look what happened. The majority is not necessarily the haqq. The majority doesn't necessarily always have to be the haqq. The haqq, many times, and history has repeated itself and has educated us that it's not about the majority, but the haqq always comes from the minority. And unity does not mean gathering 100 people or 50 people. Unity also means that in a family, having a unified family, having a union in the family. You know, one of the greatest challenges we face nowadays in the year 2017 is that we have lots of cousins and relatives. But how many of them do we speak to? How many of them can we get along with? How many of them have stopped talking to us? And how united are we? And this is why unity is the most powerful strength that any individual can obtain in order to obtain success. Any organization, if that organization is wanting to achieve success, then unity is the key to success, my brothers and sisters. And unity means that, you know, working with people and not focusing on the flaws of people, focusing on the positive attributes of people. Unity means that we work with everyone by bringing out the best of each other. Unity does not mean conformity. Unity does not mean that we have to agree with everything, no. Unity is about consulting one another. Unity is about respecting one another. Unity is about listening to one another. And that is what we need right now, my brothers and sisters, especially in Canada right now, with what happened in Quebec, and with what happened, and with what's happening now, with these attacks happening, the mosque was burnt this week, with all the hate that is taking place right now, this is a time for us Muslims, irrespective of the differences that we have, and the differences of Islamic theology and creed, this is a time now for us to look at the bigger picture. And this is a time for us now to understand this verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He says, وَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. This is the time now to unite for the betterment of our own children, for the betterment of society. You know, how good does it look when we have one organization saying this and trying to represent the whole ummah, and whereas we have so many Muslims here and we are not able to work under one leader. So this is why, my brothers and sisters, we really need to focus on the concept of unity. Starting with our homes, my brothers and sisters. If there's no unity in the home, then we can't achieve unity in the world. That is the reality, because the home is the world. Everything starts from the home, my brothers and sisters. And as parents and as leaders and as adults, we have to show our children through our actions. And we have to abstain from gossiping, we have to abstain from negativity, and we have to work towards bringing people together. And if you remember the funeral that happened recently in Montreal, what was demonstrated to us from the Right Honourable Prime Minister and from our fellow Canadians and brothers and sisters in humanity was that the whole country united. And the whole country united for what? The whole country and the leaders of the country and every single individual sympathized on what was wrong. And that we have to learn from this, my brothers and sisters. We have to learn from this. And like I said, unity does not mean conformity. Unity is being able to listen to one another, being able to value one another. That is what unity is. And that's why it's also mentioned in the Bible that behold how good and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. There's nothing better than unity. You know, many times we see that in our homes we have many obstacles and we have many problems. But the root of these problems is because as a family sometimes we are not united. The son with the father, the son with the mother, the husband with the wife, the parents with the children. And that's why unity, my brothers and sisters, is the solution. And that's why a German philosopher, he said something amazing. He said that when destruction is the motive, unity is dangerous. Many times we see people unite to destruct and to destroy, but we should never unite on the principles of destruction. We have to unite like the Quran says, that unite on the principles of goodness. And let me finish by mentioning an amazing proverb, which is an African proverb. And the proverb goes as follows, that when spider webs unite, they can tie up a lion. When spider webs unite, they can tie up a lion. I want to finish with mentioning a narration of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and his family. And this narration is an amazing narration, but before I mention the narration, I want to tell a quick story. A father was on his deathbed, and I want to welcome the Halton Region Police. And thank you so much for joining us today. A father was on his deathbed. He called all of his children, his sons. He said, come. Then he said, I have a request for you. The son said, what is the request, O father? He said, the request is, I want you to gather sticks, wooden sticks, and put them together, and I want you, all of you, to come together and try to break them. They tried, they could not break the sticks. Then he said to them, okay, individually, please try to break these sticks. So individually, they were able to break them. The moral of the story, my brothers and sisters, that when we are united, then no one can break us. And when we are together, then we are able to withstand the storms and the evil and the rumors and the negativity that exists. And the way for us to protect ourselves from hatred is when we come together and we love each other and we support each other. But if there's disunity amongst our own congregations, then the reality is it doesn't matter how much CCTV we have, it doesn't matter how much patrols we have. If we are ourselves not united, then the reality is that we have ourselves and our own brothers and sisters to fear from. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, I want to finish with this narration, authentic narration, that the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, with his family, was traveling, and I'm sure you've heard this before, but again, just to basically finish the whole point and to conclude, he was traveling with his companions, and they stopped at a place to have something to eat. So they decided to slaughter a sheep and to roast it, to barbecue it. So one of them said, I'll do the slaughtering. The other said, I'll remove the skin. And the third one said, I shall do the roasting. So each one of them volunteered to take a task. You see, the reason why I'm mentioning this is that in organizations, we need a system, and it's difficult. I know we lack resources, but you see, the reality is we need systems in place where, you know, when people come forward and they say, you know what, I can do this, so I can do this. You know, how much babysitting are we going to do? The leader is the one who does his task without being reminded. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon his family, said, I shall bring the firewood from the forest. The companion said, O Prophet, why do you take so much trouble? You know, let us do this, please. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and his family, said, I know you can do everything, but I do not like to enjoy a preferential treatment from you. God Almighty does not like to see a person distinguishing himself from his companions. Thus the Prophet went and brought firewood from the forest. The point is, my brothers and sisters, is if this was demonstrated to us by our Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, we have to follow this example. And we, in our homes, as a husband, when we see our wife struggling, you know, we have to give her a hand. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and his family, he used to help with the house errands, my brothers and sisters. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, used to help. And that's what we need to develop in our homes as well. You know, we need to help each other. When the children will see the parents helping each other, when the children will see a theme and a form of cooperation taking place in the home, then there won't be any selfishness. We have to teach our children to serve. But we can only teach our children to serve when we also serve. When we also serve. And remember, those that serve will be served in this life and the hereafter. May God Almighty allow us to to unite. May Allah God Almighty allow us to establish unity in our homes, in our communities, in our society. May God Almighty protect this country. May God Almighty protect each and every single one of us from all obstacles, from all calamities. Ameen. Wa sallallahu ta'ala ala sayyidina wa ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in bi rahmatika ya
بالمصطفى بلغ مقاصدنا واغفر لنا ما مضى يا واسع الكرم يا ربي بالمصطفى بلغ مقاصدنا واغفر لنا ما مضى يا واسع